Good afternoon, a very good afternoon, dear students. So in this lecture, we'll be discussing about physiotherapy laws and what the concepts. So in the previous lecture, we have already discussed about professional conduct, code of ethics, and the way one is supposed to behave professionally in a professional setup. And what are the concepts of morality? What is morality and the concept behind it? The communication skills, essential in healthcare. Responsibilities of physiotherapist and the status of physiotherapist in healthcare services, especially primary healthcare services, and the need for the council, which we termed as self-regulation. Then we discussed about IAP, Indian Association of Physiotherapy, the activities performed by it, roles and functions. Then WCPT, World Confederation of Physical Therapy. In the present lecture, we'll be discussing about what are physiotherapy laws. What are the duties of a medical practitioner? Then medical legal case, the case of medical negligence. What do you understand by MLC? You must have heard of the term MLC several times. What do you understand by it? What forms an MLC? How can you label an MLC? And what is medical negligence? What are the list of examples of offenses and professional misconduct? What are the laws of negligence? And then the various acts which are applicable to hospitals. So these are further guidelines of the legality. See, everything, every individual is not above law. Similarly, as a professional, as a physiotherapist, we are legally responsible for any harm that we can cause or by our negligence in prescribing a medicine as a supplementary prescriber. See, we are not entitled to prescribe a medicine to a patient. That is not part of our profession. So as a physiotherapist, if one is found to be involved in prescribing medicine as a supplementary prescriber, that is a medical offense. They could face witness to practice proceedings, criminal proceedings, if the patient has died or suffered, and in disciplinary action, which means if you've been found to involved in prescribing medicines, and because of which this can lead to death or the criminal proceedings of the patient, or patient has suffered, the patient can sue you, and also URB and disciplinary action can be taken against you. Also, this may lead to criminal proceedings. This is against the law. So they would have to give evidence in any civil litigation brought by the patient in any of the forms, or by his or her family. If the patient has died against the employer, who is vicariously liable for the negligence of the employee. So after employee who has been found to be involved in such acts of medical negligence, after him, then the employer or the organization or the hospital in which that therapist is found to be working in will also be vicariously liable, will be responsible. So it is essential that physiotherapist and occupational therapist work within the parameters of the power delegated to him or her. So whatever is being constrained or is prescribed by our association and activities which we are not entitled to, is should not be performed by us. Any concern or doubts, if he or she, means any therapist, has about the patient, I should be checked with the clinician identified. For example, if a patient has come up to you with extreme spasticity and you've been referred by a doctor to give physiotherapy management for spasticity only, then you cannot prescribe medicine. You can only rehabilitate such patient by physical means, by giving him manual therapy or electrotherapy. By no means you can prescribe medicine to the patient. If still in such situations patient asks you about if any changes or the dosage or the recommendation about any of the medicines, you can contact the clinician or neurologist, whosoever has referred the case to you. But you are not entitled to provide medicine. If the patient asks the OT or PT advice about the patient just now, which I was mentioning, then it is essential that he or she remains within the scope of their competence. Okay. Physiotherapy, rehabilitating the patient by physical means in the form of exercises, manual therapy, electrotherapy, various other modes, that is our competence. We are nowhere entitled to prescribe medicines. They may, for example, be able to suggest a medication that is available on the general sales list. but only if they are aware of any other medication that the patient may be taking, or from their knowledge and training are sure that there are no contraindications. You may advise the patient, you can discuss about the medicine, but you cannot prescribe the medicine. I would still request you to refrain yourself from even discussing the medicines with the patient, because we are not entitled to it. Then they should not advise a patient to stop or change any kind of medication. Not even prescribing, then you cannot even ask patient to stop or change any medication recommended by doctor, unless that advice is clearly within the scope of his or her knowledge. Till the time you are very sure about it, till the time you have enough competence or you have ability where you can prescribe it, till that time you should not recommend any medication. A medical practitioner has to follow the code of ethics enunciated in the statutory or international bodies. In the previous lecture, we discussed about self-regulatory bodies, we have discussed about IAP, WCPT. So there are certain code of ethics which is being given to us. As a professional, we have to follow them. If we have been found to be not following those code of ethics, that's a case of medical negligence. As they are professionals, no strict rule is framed against them, but code of ethics is framed for their compliance. That is what code of ethics are meant for. Any such violation of following code of ethics is further taken as professional misconduct. In general, rules framed under a statute are mandatory ordinary people, but code of ethics is for professional. For a civilian, for an ordinary people, they are statute there to other civil law, but then we are, as professionals, we have to follow the code of ethics. Duties of a medical practitioner. So as a medical practitioner, as a physiotherapist, we are also liable to perform certain activities. We are also entitled to perform certain duties, which comes under various sections of the society. First is duties to patient. We are answerable, we are liable to patients. Duties to public, duties to law enforcers. Duties not to violate any professional ethics, not to violate any of the code of ethics which has been set by the association or the governing body. Duties not to do anything illegal or hide illegal acts. Duties to each other, means your colleagues, your subordinates, your senior, your superiors, that is, comes under Colleague Impairment Act. Then duty as health officer, notification of infectious disease. For example, if you get to examine a patient who is HIV positive, so that needs to be informed to your colleagues as well. That should be informed to everyone around. Then responding to emergency medical services. Maintenance of medical records. Patients' records comes under directly their security and safety and privacy of the medical records is to be taken care of by the therapist himself. Then the disclosure of crime, means reporting. Now what is medical legal case? You must have heard of the term medical legal case several times. What exactly does it mean? In the short, we call it MLC. It refers to a case of injury or illness that indicates investigation by law enforcement agencies to establish and fix the criminal responsibility or the case according to the law of the country. What does it mean? Now break or split the definition. It refers to the case of injury or illness. Assume there are cases, or we'll be talking about what are these possibilities that indicates investigation by law enforcement. For example, there's a case of poisoning. For example, there's a case of undetermined coma, or there's an injury, road traffic accident, for which law enforcement or investigation is required. So that needs to be fixed, that needs to be taken care of by the police first or the federal government first, and then that case can be taken care of later. So any medical case which require legal intervention to investigate the cause of the occurrence is MLC, medical legal case. It requires judgment of CMO and not the family members. It will be the CMO who will be determining the cause and will be going in deep into it, then only further intervention can be done. So that is a medical legal case. So all medical officers working in hospitals, field medical units, non-medical unit encounter medical legal issues. You may in your practice must have encountered with several of such medical legal cases, especially in emergency care, which should be handled in accordance with the law of the land. What where the area where are you practicing, that also determines what is the law of the land. Then, since law and order is a state subject, there are differences in legal procedure being followed by different states. So, if you are practicing in Delhi, there's a different law and order which is being narrated by state government from one state to the other. So, you need to follow the law of the land in which you are practicing. That is, I hope medical legal case is understood. Next is, when do you call a case medical legal case? How can you label this case as medical legal case? Also, the files in which the data or the documents is kept for such patients is also labeled as MLC. If you ever worked in hospital, you must have seen those stickers or sticky notes which are put over those files on the front cover of that file, which mentions as MLC or a medical legal case. When do you label it? What are those instances? What are those cases? So first, how can you do that? Who has the right to do it? So RMO, casualty medical officer, CMO, MO in charge, medical officer in charge of MI room, duty medical officer, which means on duty medical officer, MO in charge of ward, who is attending to the case may label a case as MLC. Only these people have a right to call any case as a medical legal case. No other person has the right to label this case as medical legal case. So the decision to label a case as MLC should be based on sound professional judgment. Okay. It should be, a case is decided to be an MLC by sound professional judgment. After a detailed history taking, you need to go into the depth or in thorough investigation or thorough history taking only after that, or thorough clinical examination, and only after that you call a case as MLC. What are the examples of MLC? Like we were discussing, like assault and battery involving including domestic violence or a child abuse, accidents like road traffic accidents, industrial accidents, cases of trauma with suspicion of foul play. For example, if a patient reports to be falling on the stairs but his history is suggesting something else, then electrical injuries, burns, poisoning, alcohol intoxication, undiagnosed coma, chemical injuries, burns and scalds, sexual offenses, criminal abortions, attempted suicides, case of suicides like by hanging, strangulation, drowning, suffocation, custodial deaths, then unnatural deaths, deaths due to snake bites or animal bites, firearm injuries, and then there are many, many more. All these generally forms a medical legal case. Then these are certain important terms to understand. There are certain points to be understood. Healthcare personnel must understand the basic medical legal issues involved in personal injury, negligence, malpractice, medical frauds, and professional incompetency, along with ethical issues in human experimentation. Defensive medicine, organ transplants, reproduction medicines. So these are the areas of which law should be aware to you. As one of the practitioner, you should be aware of these laws. What does a service means? Term service refers to as means service of any description but excludes free service and personal service. Treatment in a hospital on payment amounts to hiring of a service for consideration. Now, what does medical negligence refers to? You also must have heard of the term medical negligence. Now, medical negligence is any act of omission or commission which is not expected from a person of average intelligence. Means we all, in spite of those who have very high IQ, other than those, a person with even with average intelligence, okay, some is expected to behave in a certain way when they're dealing with patients. So an act of omission or commission which is not expected of a person of an average intelligence of same qualification and experience, means here you will compare the act of accused with the act of somebody who is not involved in the case, is a normal human being given the standard circumstances. So this is known as medical negligence. So error in finding the diagnosis is not negligence. Error in finding the diagnosis is not negligence. Treatment can be an act of negligence, but not diagnosis. Now, what are the list of offences and professional misconduct? When do you call that this person is conducted, he is doing misconduct professionally? When do you call it? For example, adultery, one basic example. Then improper conduct. You know, we have discussed about professional conduct, the way you are supposed to behave, then the communication skills. So, if anybody is indulged in the act of adultery or improper conduct, or associated with a patient or a member of the family, that is an offense or professional misconduct. Then issuing false certificates, reports and other documents, like for example, hospitals are the place where one gets birth certificate, death certificate, sickness, leaves, false medical reports. These are very common nowadays. If somebody is being found to be involved in such cases, so that's an offense, medical offense. Conviction by court of law for offense involving moral factors. We have discussed this point under code of ethics. Performing or enabling an unqualified person to perform any illegal operation. For example, if somebody who is not competent enough or is not entitled to perform that surgery. For example, if somebody who has an expertise in medicine, okay, is performing a surgery. So that's an offense, that's a criminal offense, which there is no medical, surgical or psychological indication. Issuing certificates of efficiency in modern medicine to unqualified or non-medical person. For example, in the previous lecture only we were discussing about quacks, like the people who are not qualified enough to get that certificate are being awarded or being issued those certificates. So those are called quacks. So advertisement of the services or the institution run by the physician, that's an offense. Using unusually large signboards other than name, qualifications and specialty, or fixing signboards at places other than that of residence or practice, that's an offense. Disclosing secrets of the patient. Patient secrecy and privacy should not be taken for granted. That should be given the utmost importance. Performing operation without consent. This has to be an informed consent, informed and signed consent, written consent, which should be taken from each and every patient before you attend. Will not use agents for procuring business. Then treatment. When it comes to treatment, proper recording of patient's history, questions about his or her drug allergy should be asked beforehand, goal planning only. So monitor the condition of all patients continuously. If failure to do so, liable to lead to hospital management under the doctrine of vicarious liability. So once a patient is admitted, he or she is your responsibility in your area. You have to take regular follow-ups of the patient. Failure to do so leads to that's an offense, and you are answerable to hospital management as well. So now these are certain instances of medical negligence. Medical negligence may take following forms: failure to monitoring patient's condition, improper or malfunctioning equipment. You've been using equipment which is not working properly. Then inadequate nursing supervision and staffing. Leaving a swab or instrument inside patient's body during operation. Or you must be familiar of right-left. For example, the left part of the body is to be treated, whereas you open the right side of the body. That's a case of medical negligence. Okay. Failure to obtain informed consent from the patient. Okay. Then failure to protect a patient from risk of an infection. It is only because of the act of operation or your treatment only that patient received or got that infection. Negligent administration of an injection, wrong injection. For example, there's an injection which is to be delivered to bed number 10, okay, with a name Mr. X, and then bed number 11 is of also same name, and that injection is by negligence is being administered or injected to bed number 11. So that's an act of medical negligence. It could be intramuscular or intravenous injection. Law of negligence. There are certain laws under which we work. First is causing death by negligence. Because of your act of negligence, patient is being found to be suffering or being found to be dead. Then what is criminal rashness? The word itself suggests the act of behavior. Criminal rashness is hazarding, a dangerous or a wanton act with the knowledge that it is so and that it may cause injury or knowledge that injury will probably be caused. For example, that particular person is aware of the repercussions. He knows that if he'll do this treatment, the patient may get suffered. This can be harmful for the patient, but he still goes ahead with it. So that is criminal rashness. What is criminal negligence? It refers to the conduct in which a person ignores a person. Okay, a known or obvious risk. You know that you're not 100% certain, but you know that there is a risk of getting infection, or there is a risk that patient might not be able to survive, and you don't get consent for the same. That is the act of criminal negligence, where you're compromising the safety of the other, the life of the other individual or the patient. Then what is civil negligence? Civil negligence, you can very well understand by this term that civil negligence is also termed as due diligence, which means because of the act of, for example, let me put it in that way. For example, this servant who was in a hospital setup only, the housekeeping staff is mopping the floor, okay, but then that person or that servant forgot to put the wet floor sign, because of which you have increased the risk of patient's fall, or one of the hospital staff may fall over that floor. So that's an act of negligence, which is not directly associated with medical field. So that is why it is called as civil negligence. Or let me put it in the other way. Another example is, for example, there's a drug which is to be marketed, has come out, but the trials are not finished yet. The human trial or the animal trial is not finished yet, but still you have launched the drug or you have administered the drug. So that's an act of civil negligence. Now what is contributory negligence? Contributory negligence, now I only suggest your contribution in the act of negligence, which means that you're not directly involved in the act of negligence, okay, but you were one of those people who were aware of that there's something which is going on. So how can one determine that whether you have contributed in this act or not? There are 2-3 factors by which that is determined. First, contributory negligence is determined that whosoever is accused, whether he or she is in a position so that the victim can suffer, first point. Second point is that if they are in the position, were they aware of that what practice is being going on? Okay, so that's contributory negligence, which means they were aware of something which is going on. You are not directly responsible, you were not involved as such physically in the act of negligence, but you were aware of that what is going on, but still you failed to report it. That's contributory negligence. Then what are the acts which are applicable to the hospitals? Naming a few: Indian Medical Council Act 1933, Indian Nursing Council Act 1947, the Pharmacy Act 1948, then Birth and Deaths in Marriages, Registration Act, and then PNDT Acts. These are several acts which are applicable. Other examples are Societies Registration Act 1860, State Public Charitable Trust Acts, Establishment of Hospitals or Nursing Homes, Shops and Establishment Act, Law of Torts, and Consumer Protection Act. Amongst all these acts, we have Consumer Protection Act in our syllabus, which we'll be talking in our next lecture. So these are certain practice questions, and here are your references. I hope it is clear to you all. Thank you.